way that health is marketed to us, we need to remember that it's marketed to us by the diet culture. There are very few people who eat when they're hungry and stop when they're full. Because if you can master that, you'll never have a problem with your weight ever again. Being healthy is not about cooking from scratch every single day. It's about making the best choice for you. And if that means you've got to factor in convenience because you haven't got the time or the capacity or the inclination to cook, then why not?
On this week's episode of the Engaging Marketeer, I am speaking to Hayley Field, the food ninja. Hayley helps business owners like myself eat healthily, get the right mindset to eat healthily, and be more happy about their own physical appearance and physical health. So I'm going to be getting some tips from Hayley on how I can turn this into an Adonis. Well, how I can turn this into less of this is probably more what we're going to be talking about. Your brand.
Yes.
Ninja.
Yes.
What made you want to do Ninja? Because back in the UK, I mean, you're too young to remember this, but we had Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And Ninja was a naughty word. They couldn't call them Ninja.
Really?
They had to change it to Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles in the UK. They were not allowed to say the word Ninja. It for children in the UK, in case they went out and did naughty things and started chopping each other.
Oh, in case they started fighting each other, yeah.
So what made you pick Ninja?
Well, like all true ninjas, the name was bestowed upon me by someone else, actually.
Yeah, of course it was. Of course it was.
When I first started so I've been running my business for about 10 years now. So I retrained because previously I used to work in the corporate world as an IT consultant. So how I got into what I'm doing now is I joined a CrossFit box and I helped out someone with a nutrition challenge, my mentor, a guy called Martin Foster. And I got really sort of interested in it. And one of the members was asking a question about dates. And I said, oh, yeah, they've got like 73% carbs. You know, they're sort of like a bit of a sneaky saboteur of your macros. And he said to me, wow, Hayley, you're quite the food ninja these days. And it kind of stuck. I was like, that's amazing. I should get that on a T-shirt. But instead, I just called my whole business it.
And do you have it on a T-shirt now?
I do. Yeah, I do. I should have worn it today, shouldn't I? I've got lots of merch. I'm just looking around for it. I've got these little pin badges that my clients get. So that's a black belt look.
Oh, I love a pin badge.
Yeah. So they have, obviously they start at white belt and then we've got black belts. Just to gamify it a little bit. But yeah, I've got all sorts of merch now. It's ripe for merch, Food Ninja.
And the graphics you've got there, the little ninja characters, the little anime characters. Did you get somebody to actually design those up for you?
Yeah, a really, really clever person called G. Sabini Roberts. So they are a sort of branding expert. Mm. And yeah, they did all the branding for me. They're amazing.
Right. So with your Food Ninja brand, how exactly do you help businesses? Do you go in and like punch food out of their faces and stop them from eating?
Not exactly. I mean,
that's
I'm
a shame.
Sure
I had a vision then.
Yeah, I'm sure some people would like me to use that tactic. But yeah, so originally it was Food Ninja because obviously I was just doing nutrition and I retrained in nutrition and, you know, stopped my corporate job and whatever. And then when I was working with people on their nutrition, I realized very quickly that the reason people couldn't maintain a healthy weight was actually nothing to do with food. Like everyone knows what they're supposed to eat. So I then did lots of other qualifications. So I'm a qualified sleep science coach. I'm a stress and recovery coach, a health mindset coach, and also a CBT practitioner. Because I realized that a lot of it was quite, you know, it's more mindset and to do with things, you know, attitudes and beliefs about food, which is why people can't stay healthy. And while I was doing this, I noticed that a group of people who are quite underserved in that area, but absolutely need help, is business owners. So I would say like 95% of my clients are business owners. And, you know, they all come to me saying they want to lose weight for various different reasons. You know, some of them might feel not that great, but also if you are the face of your business and you are how you get business, you know, putting yourself out there on video, speaking on stages, all that kind of stuff. If you don't feel comfortable with, you know, not just, it's not just about weight, you know, if you don't feel comfortable with how you look, but also how it's making you feel not being that healthy, it's really hard to put yourself out there and represent your business and be, you know, really enthusiastic and do lots of networking and all that kind of stuff. So I think I get a lot of sort of clients from that perspective, but also this kind of a hustle and grind culture. We're all told, you know, unless you work yourself to death, you don't deserve to be successful and all of that kind of stuff. So that's a lot of the reason why I did a lot of the kind of stress and recovery qualifications. I look at people, you know, helping people with their sleep, some of the unhelpful coping mechanisms that they're using, like, you know, alcohol to wind down at night, you know, Pro Plus, nootropics, all of that kind of stuff, which are just really like sticking plasters on a bit of a wound, really.
You know, I felt like I was in a coaching session then, because you were pretty much describing me, the whole concept of getting out there and networking for your business and speaking on a stage, which I do a lot of, and not feeling comfortable about your weight and your physical appearance. A lot of my clothes have shrunk over the years. I don't know why that's
what happened during the pandemic. Something weird happened to people's clothes during the pandemic.
Mine started long before that, and every time I buy them, then they shrink and I have to buy different ones, and you know, the sizes are not what I used to be buying. It's weird. And then you see all these business gurus and mentors, and I think Stephen Bartlett does it on his podcast as well, about, you know, he gets up at like 5 a.m. and spends an hour doing some sort of reading, and you're told that you need to do that to be successful. If you don't get up at 5, then you're just wasting your life. And that's really not me.
It's very toxic as well, I find, and it's just such a lot of expectation. You know, I find that one of the most difficult things that I have to do with all of my clients is persuade them that when they have downtime, it's not wasted time. I actually had a client who said she felt like she was annoyed that she had to sleep because she felt like it was a waste of time. And I was like, it's kind of a primary biological need rather than a luxury. You know, you maybe sort of try and reframe that. So that's one of the things that I have the biggest battle with, is this mindset shift of actually, how do you define success? Because if you are all about the hustle and grind and you're working 18 hours a day and you're surviving on junk food and caffeine and alcohol, and you're so tired at the end of the day.
That's me.
Like, are you successful? Because if you've got a six-figure business, but you don't have the time, the energy, or the capacity to enjoy the fruits of your labor, why should we define that as successful?
I'm being told off now. I'm being told off. But no, you're right, because you can be successful in business, but not successful in your own personal health. And if you're too tired to get up on a weekend and do what you want to do, then are you really winning?
Exactly. I think health should also be a measure of someone's success. And also, you know, if we're being very blunt about it, we live in a, unfortunately, very judgmental society. So if you're trying to get new business, you know, and there's someone stood next to you with exactly the same experience and qualifications, but they look like they have their stuff together and you don't.
You can say shit together. I know you were going to.
Oh, good. Do you know what? I've been really editing myself. You know, I've got a terrible potty mouth, which you might have seen from some of my content if you looked at me. But yes, I'm not very good at editing myself generally. But yeah, if you don't look like you've got your shit together, why should a client trust you with theirs? And that's horrible, because your appearance is no reflection on how good you are at your job. But I think we do still live in a judgmental society where people think, oh, well, they, you know, she doesn't look like she's got her shit together. Why should I listen to her?
Yeah. No, you're right. Because if you're standing on a stage and presenting, or you're going into a client meeting, people want to buy from people they like. People want to buy from people they aspire to be. Yeah. And if, like me, you've got a couple of spare tires and you're shaped like a pear, then people are going to look at that and go, do I want to be like him? Maybe not. So yeah, it's superficial, perhaps, but it's also contrary to the way life used to be, because back in, we're talking like Victorian times, the fatter you were, the more you were, people aspired to be like you, because it meant you could afford to eat.
You could afford to eat all of the good stuff.
Rich people were fat, and they all wanted to, the women, the men, they all wanted to be fat because it meant they were rich and they were of status. Yes. Whereas now, if you're thin, you're of status. It's weird how it's changed.
Yeah, and that's, I do work predominantly with women business owners, and that's something that, that's another layer on top. And I know it's the same for men, because you get all these kind of like alpha males with their like six pack. I mean, I don't know if you saw recently, there was a guy, he owns a fitness company, and he did a video which went viral on TikTok saying that he only wants people who have six packs to work for him. That was one of the stipulations in the interview, which is absolutely ridiculous. But, so I know that men are also subjected to these things, but women in particular, and certainly women, of a certain age. So like I'm in my 40s now, and definitely you do notice this sea change of, the way, being judged for the way that you look, and particularly for women, when they sort of stand up in a meeting or something like that, there is this extra layer of judgment that's going on. And it's particularly women of my age, you can't win if you go there sort of looking put together and present, presented, they're kind of like, oh wow, why has she got time to go to the gym and stuff, who's looking after her kids? And then if you turn up looking not that way, oh wow, she's let herself go and now she's looking older and all that kind of stuff. So there's so many complexities to this sort of body image and being judged for the way you look rather than what you can do.
And how do you propose somebody actually gets around that, whether it's men or women, the whole idea that if I'm in shape and I'm dressed well and I'm got a nice watch on and sunglasses, and people are going to think, what a prick. Or if I didn't mean it like that, but if I'm dressed in a hoodie and like I am now and a t-shirt and jeans and gut spilling out over me trousers, I don't want to give you too much graphic detail, but you get the idea. People look and go, he's not that bothered about the way he looks. There is this fine line that you have, but that fine line is just to please certain people.
How
do you balance that when pleasing yourself and pleasing other people? And how do you do it?
I think the most important thing is to feel right about what you're doing for yourself. You can see when someone isn't taking care of themselves and they know it, and it shows in their demeanor and the way they might be speaking or presenting or whatever. And that is when people will lose people. Whereas you might look exactly the same, but you're happy with it. You've made some compromises or sacrifices and you've decided that they're worth it. Maybe you're happy with the way that you're looking after yourself, but it doesn't show in, your weight or whatever. I think if you are happy with, your self-respect, if you are looking after yourself, it gives you self-respect, self-esteem, and that comes across regardless of what age, size, shape, clothes you're wearing, it will still come through. So I think if you are happy with the way that you're looking after yourself, that will come through regardless.
So to make it really simple then, you could be the jolly, happy, fat guy that everybody wants to talk to because he's just the life and soul of everything and he's happy and content in how he is. Or you could be the miserable, fit person who is trying not to do anything that's going to disturb their own physical fitness because they're going to get really unhappy if they sway one way or the other.
Yeah.
So it's all about how you feel about yourself and how you feel about your own confidence.
Yeah, absolutely. If you, it is about balance. And I know everyone rolls their eyes when a fitness person says that because they're like, oh, everything in moderation, which, by the way, is really shitty advice because what's moderation for you is not moderation for me. It's got zero context. So I think Yes, you've got to be happy with your choices and let that sort of shine through in your delivery or your networking and whatever when you're meeting people. So be happy with your own choices.
Well, networking's an interesting point because I do a lot of networking. I've been to a networking meeting this morning. I've got another one tomorrow morning. So typically I do at least one a week, sometimes two or more a week. And as with most things business related with networking, they all involve food.
Yes.
So the networking meeting I had this morning, it was a full fry-up English breakfast. The one I've got tomorrow is the same. Yes, there are other options, but you never tick those other options. If you're doing these networking meetings all the time and they're all based around food, sometimes they're very early in the morning, sometimes it's later, how can you as a business owner go to these things, participate with everybody else, yet still not gorge yourself on fry-up after fry-up and basically get to where I am right now?
Yeah, I think it's, environment has a lot to answer for, doesn't it? The way we design our environment, it will nudge us towards different choices, isn't it? That's what they do in the supermarkets, like choice architecture. They build everything so that they push us into these decisions about making, buying things, what we're going to buy, what we could see at our eye level and stuff like that. So I think to rely on your willpower in these situations just isn't going to work. Willpower is finite. If I go into a room and I can smell bacon and that's what's on offer, or there's like some sad looking muesli in the corner that no one's touched, I'm probably going to have the bacon sandwich, because why wouldn't you? But I think in that instance, it's about connecting with your reason for wanting to be healthier. And I always use with my clients something called an alter ego. So, Food Ninja is my alter ego, if you like. So she's the person who, she's super healthy. She always makes the right choice about everything and always eats the right thing in any situation and all that kind of stuff. But also I get my clients to do that and embody, what kind of person do you want to be? Do you want to be the fit dad who plays football in the park with your kids? Do you want to be the business person who goes to a meeting and is like really switched on because you haven't got like, you're not in a carb coma from six rounds of toast and whatever within the breakfast? So I think connecting with why you might want to make better choices and who you want to become, rather than just rocking up to the thing and expecting willpower to do its thing, because that just ain't gonna happen.
Everything you've said essentially boils back down to mindset, doesn't it? It's about what you want and what you're happy with, what your target is and what your goal is. So to make it as simple as possible, how do you do that?
Mindset is a lifelong thing that you need to work on.
So it's not something you can tell us in 5 minutes and just suddenly, oh yeah, that's the answer, and we can all go away and be fit.
Unfortunately not. I would be rich if I could do that. But I think this is part of the issue, right? Because again, I'm going to say particularly for women, but I know this happens for men as well. The way that health is marketed to us, we need to remember that it's marketed to us by the diet culture. That's not what health is. Our idea of health is what we're being told by Slimming World and Weight Watchers and people who do keto and all this kind of stuff. That's not health. So this expectation that we have that someone should give us a set of rules to follow about what we should eat, how we should behave, how we should exercise. And then in 12 weeks time, because 12 week transformation is normally the thing, isn't it? In 12 weeks time, all our problems will be solved. So if they aren't, that's not because you've done something wrong. It's because, A, there's unrealistic expectations, because that's just not possible. And B, the method that you've chosen is not sustainable. So, again, Slimming World is one of my I've got a video on TikTok that went viral of my opinion of Slimming World. I'll just leave that there if anyone wants to go and look it up, because it's quite entertaining.
I'll put a link below the podcast to that video so people can check that one out.
I got a lot of hate on that video. It's a cult, Slimming World. It really is.
If you're not getting hate, you're not doing it right. So
yeah, exactly. So yeah, we've got these unrealistic expectations. And then we pick a method that's not sustainable, which is why everyone wants to know when they hear someone that they haven't heard before. Can you tell me what's the thing? Like, everyone's like, when I get a new client, they always look in my fitness pal where I track my food, because they think as a nutritionist, there must be a secret food that I eat that, you know, maybe it's a thing that all nutritionists are in on and we're just not sharing the secret with you. There is no secret. There's no quick fix. I've got clients who are with me. I've got a client who's been with me for 3 years. You know, this is what I want to tell people. To get fit and healthy will take a long time. It doesn't take a 12-week transformation program, because you need to work from the inside out. Everyone's worried about the outside and what the outside looks like and when will people notice that I've lost weight. But to make it really stick, you need to work from the inside out. So you need to start with, what are your beliefs around food? How did you come to have the relationship with food that you now have? What happened for you to have that relationship with food? Do you display any behaviors around food that you wish that you didn't? Where did they come from? So it's starting at that level and trying to repair your relationship with food and exercise, because most people see exercise as a punishment or a chore. Mm. When really we should be celebrating what our bodies can do, because they're pretty freaking amazing. You know, if you go into a gym and deadlift 120 kilos or whatever, I mean, that's amazing, right? So working from the inside out and looking at your beliefs, your attitude, and your mindset about stuff. And the mindset thing is really hard, which is why I have clients who stay with me for 2-3 years, because they are in such a fixed mindset about their health and their weight, because they've tried so many diets and they've failed at all of them. Mm. Which is when I have to say to them, it's the diet that's failed you. It's unsustainable. It doesn't work. You know, everyone can try and keep an eye on what they keep put in their mouth, but unless you sort out what's going on in your head about it, you've got no chance.
Mm. So Slimming World's a load of bollocks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
What about meal substitutes? Such as like Juice Plus or other types of...
Juice Plus is a big no, and Herbalife, big no.
Big no, right.
I mean, Herbalife has been found to have like trace elements of metals and all sorts of crap in it. It's
really?
Not a good, yeah, it's not a good thing.
Wow.
To, not a good thing to do at all.
Arbonne?
Pardon?
Arbonne?
No.
No.
Any sort of... Multi-level marketing, I'll probably get a lot of hate for this.
Generally,
and this is my issue with Slimming World as well, the Slimming World consultants, as they're called, don't have any nutrition qualifications. The same with someone who tries to sell you Arbonne or Herbalife. They don't have any qualifications whatsoever. Like, when I come to work with a client, I don't have a syllabus, so I do completely bespoke one-to-one coaching. And that's because, you know, you are the expert in you. I want to learn from you what you're all about and what you need before I can give you a solution. So to say that, you know, just drink this shake twice a day, like it's not sustainable. It's not going to work. Mm. What if you have a stressful job? Stress can make you hungrier. What if you don't sleep well? Sleep affects your hunger hormone and, you know, it means that you don't make great decisions the next day. It makes you more tired, so you move about less. You know, maybe you don't have a lot of time to cook. All of that kind of stuff. They don't know any of this. Meal replacements do have their place. So something like a full meal replacement. I mean, I'm not a massive fan, but Huel is a meal replacement. And if you're really, really, really busy, so you've been sat at your desk all day and the choice is phone delivery and just get like a pizza or get someone to deliver you a sandwich, or have a Huel, like the Huel is going to be better for you because it's more balanced. It's got protein in it. It's got nutrients. And, you know, being pragmatic, if you're really busy, maybe that's a quick way to eat your lunch. But I definitely wouldn't eat every single meal as a meal replacement shake.
So if you are really busy, so for example, my routine, unless I'm at a networking meeting, I don't have breakfast.
Yeah.
I just don't think the idea of eating food in the morning is something that I want to do.
Yeah.
Quite often, I'll skip lunch.
Right.
So I often won't eat anything until the evening. Not every day. Maybe two or 3 days a week, I'll skip something until the evening.
Yeah.
But I do drink. I drink coffee throughout the day. Probably 6-7 cups of coffee a day is a minimum for me. And then I might have beer or wine in the evening. And I say might. It's almost a certainty. So I don't think I eat a lot. I don't eat a lot of calories. But I do drink a lot of calories. My coffee is black, no sugar, though. So, you know, there's some goodness in there. Where am I going wrong, obviously?
So I would say, you know, you don't have to eat breakfast if you don't like breakfast. I personally don't eat breakfast. I usually, I try and live by the rule, I eat when I'm hungry. And I don't normally get hungry till between 11 and 12. So that's when I'll eat.
That's interesting, because some people, they don't eat when they're hungry, do they? They eat out of habit. Like, I used to watch films in the evening before we had to move out of the house we're in now for insurance reasons, and I would always get a load of snacks for the film, even though I wasn't really hungry. I wasn't really want to eat them. It's just because I associated eating a bag of minstrels with watching a film.
There are very few people, and this is why we're in the situation we're in now, there are very few people who eat when they're hungry and stop when they're full. Because if you can master that, you'll never have a problem with your weight ever again, regardless of what you eat.
We're all Labradors, aren't we? We just keep eating if it's there.
Yeah, because, you know, we live in an obesogenic environment. We are bombarded with images and opportunities to eat for reasons other than hunger. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't eat for reasons other than hunger, because, you know, we all eat emotionally because food is a comfort to us. It's a source of, like, it's celebration. It's cultural. We have all of these associations and memories with food, and it can be, you know, joyful and a nice experience. But when you eat emotionally, and rather than making you feel good, it makes you feel shit, because then you're guilty, embarrassed, ashamed. That's when we get the issue of emotional eating, you know, doing more harm than good. But yeah, I work with people on recognizing when they're hungry, which sounds really stupid, but
it does. It sounds obvious, doesn't it? But it's not.
I know. We don't have to be hungry now in this, you know, we're so lucky. We don't have to be hungry. We can literally pick up our mobile phone and get hot food to our house in like 10 minutes. So when I work with people, I always say to them, like, we do the hunger scale. And they know what it's like to feel 10 hungry, because a bit like you, they probably maybe are not eating all day, and then they get to the end of the day and they're like, oh my God, I'm absolutely starving. I'm number 10 hungry. They know what zero hungry feels like, because they eat until they're so full that they're like, oh my God, I definitely could not eat another bite. I'm zero hungry right now. But if I say to them, well, what does a 4 feel like? You know, if you're 4 hungry or 6 hungry, no idea. They can't tell me the symptoms of being a number 4 hungry. They can't tell me what it feels like. They can't tell me what they would eat if they were number 4 hungry. You know, they have completely disassociated from their hunger and satiety signals. So learning that skill, when am I actually hungry, like properly hungry, and when am I actually full? You know, eating till you're about 80% full is a skill. But it's a skill that will stop you putting weight on, because then you'll never be 100%, you know, or what I call Christmas dinner full, which is what a lot of people eat too.
Oh, yeah. Christmas dinner full when dessert 4 comes out. Oh, I couldn't possibly. Oh, is that Christmas cake? Oh, God.
Yeah. I've had a Christmas cake. I can't have anything else. But here comes a mince pie.
Oh, yes. Oh, trifle. Oh, there's always room for trifle.
Oh, I love trifle.
I mean, it's so soft, isn't it? It's not really food. It fills a gap. It somehow gets in there. So I take it from this then, are you not an advocate of calorie counting?
Oh, no, I am, definitely. Oh? Well, for different reasons. So I do get people to track their food if it's appropriate, because obviously I work with a lot of different people. Some of them, maybe most of them, because they're business owners, have type A obsessive personalities. So we need to be a little bit careful about tracking and stuff, because they do, you know, business owners are very outcome oriented. Aren't we? I'm including myself in this, because I'm the, like this, I am this typical person that I'm describing. And to try and get them to detach from the outcome and just trust the process and get invested in the process and enjoying the daily behaviors that you need to get the outcome is really, really hard. Because they want, give me targets, give me this, give me that, tell me what I want to eat. And I'm just like, okay, we're going to take a step back and we're going to track food, but we're going to do it from an awareness point of view. So yes, I do normally give people a protein target, because everyone undereats on protein, and it's so, so important, like incredibly important, probably the most important thing about what you eat. So I might give them a target for that. But other than that, we're tracking for awareness, because if I asked you, like, what did you eat yesterday? You probably can't remember.
I'm genuinely thinking now. I did have lunch yesterday. I didn't have breakfast. I had chicken sandwiches for lunch with a pork pie and a little mini piece of Cathedral City cheese.
Oh, so you can remember. That's quite unusual.
I can, because it was right in front of me. I was sat right here. And then when I got home, we had, you know, this is embarrassing. I can't remember. The wife made it. What did we have? I remember I had a very small glass of wine, because I had what was left from the day before, because I had almost a full bottle the day before. And then two glasses of gin and tonic. That was a light evening's drinking for me. Food. Oh, yes. We had fish with peas and new potatoes.
Okay, good. So you can remember. That's quite unusual.
Remember. Yeah.
Because most people have no idea what they eat. I was about to say, along with that, there was probably some stuff that you ate mindlessly, because everyone does it.
And like some toffees.
Things you can't even remember eating.
Which I shouldn't have had, because I wasn't hungry.
So we track from an awareness point of view, because it's a massive eye-opener. Someone's like, I just don't understand how I've just put weight on slowly over the years. And then you get them to track their food for a day, and they're like, oh, I've eaten 3,500 calories. I don't really understand how that's happened. Or some people, you know, especially with business owners, they're so busy and absorbed in their business that they haven't really got time to think about, well, what's in this food that I'm eating? Is there any protein? You know, I've had people go a whole day without eating any protein whatsoever, because they just haven't got the capacity to think about those things. So I do think tracking and calorie counting is useful, because the only way to lose fat is to be in a calorie deficit. And once you understand that principle, you don't need all these other stupid diets like Slimming World and Keto and Weight Watchers, because that's all that's happening, is they are using some shitty proprietary method to get you in a calorie deficit. But they don't want you to know that, because once you know that, then you don't have to pay them anymore. You know, they're creating a reliance. I mean, the woman who owns Slimming World even said her business model is about retention. You know, whereas I say to my clients, you know, I love my clients, but I don't want you to be my client forever and ever. I want to sort you for life. And then you go away, and in the nicest possible way, I don't want to see you again, because I don't want you to keep going through this process all of the time. And, you know, to make sure that happens, I give people free aftercare afterwards. So, you know, 3 months after they finish coaching, I will have another call with them and say, is everything still working? If it's not working, I'll coach them for free until whatever it was that isn't working sticks. And there's not that, I don't know of another health coach who does that, because everyone uses their method.
Yeah. Well, in many ways, your business model is quite flawed, because you're like a driving instructor. The better you are, the shorter you work with a client, and then you never have to see them again.
Yes. But, you know, there's so many people who need help. So I'm okay. There's a steady stream, of people who need to be sorted out.
And presumably as well, when you help people, they'll refer you to others. Oh, she was amazing. She did this. And no, I don't need any of this rubbish diets.
I've been running my business for 10 years, and I've never done a single penny of paid advertising.
Wow. That's impressive.
Yeah.
That's impressive. So as a business owner then, what kind of things should I be avoiding and what kind of things should I be ensuring I do eat?
So number one, I would say hydration, because...
And you don't mean coffee, do you?
I don't mean coffee, no.
You mean water.
Coffee isn't that bad.
Mm.
Okay, so I would never say to someone, stop drinking coffee, because if you enjoy it, you know, what's the point of making yourself miserable? Because, you know, you want your days to be enjoyable. You don't want to be sat there thinking about how you'd be love to be on your third cup of coffee by now, make you miserable. So what I would say is, in the morning when you wake up, try and delay your first cup of coffee by about 90 minutes. I know, horrifying, right? And drink a pint of water instead. So the reason for that is you've got these like receptors. So you've got this substance in your body that builds up and makes you sleepy. And when you wake up in the morning, not all of that substance is left your body yet. But when you drink coffee, coffee binds on to that substance and has it hanging around in your bloodstream a bit more. So when the caffeine eventually goes, you're just left with that, which is what that afternoon crash is, because then you're sleepy again. So if you can drink some water and give that a chance to clear out of your bloodstream, hang on for 90 minutes and then drink a coffee, you're much less likely to get that afternoon slump.
Okay. So on a weekday for me, my alarm goes off, unless I'm at a networking meeting, 7 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
I get into work for 9 o'clock. So I typically don't have a coffee until after 9 o'clock.
Okay, good. Awesome. That's so you're probably, already doing it.
Well, unintentionally, it's because I'm so sluggish. But I'm not drinking water in the morning. So you're suggesting I should probably drink a pint of water before I leave the house?
Yes.
Before I get into work. And that'll help.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I would try and drink a further 3 pints of water throughout the day. So an easy way to remember to do this. So you have the pint in the morning when you wake up. And then every time you eat something.
All I heard you say then is have a pint in the morning when you wake up. I can do that.
You're like, yeah, perfect. So have a pint every time you eat something. Mm-hmm. So obviously you don't eat breakfast, like try and eat some lunch, I would suggest, definitely. Have a pint of water then. Have a pint of water with your evening meal. And then, you know, maybe have a pint, like I have this on my desk all the time, a 1 litre bottle, because if it's there on my desk staring at me, I'll remember to drink it. So maybe getting a water bottle or something. I mean, I drink squash. You don't have to be boring and drink plain water. So yeah, you can put some flavors and stuff in it, but 100% hydration, because if you do drink alcohol, you will be dehydrated basically as soon as you wake up. If you're drinking alcohol in the evening, you'll be dehydrated when you wake up. Mm. And then if you're just drinking coffee all day, you know, it's a bit of a myth that coffee makes you dehydrated, but it doesn't hydrate you in the same way. So you definitely need to add some other liquids into it, non-alcoholic.
Okay. And in terms of lunch, what sort of things should somebody like me be eating, and what sort of stuff should we be avoiding?
So you want to keep yourself nice and full, obviously. So protein is so important. So protein is really important for maintaining our lean muscle mass, because as we get older, we get something called age-related sarcopenia, which is where our natural muscle mass starts to waste. And that's why, you know, if you don't keep on top of your protein, you are going to be the 70-year-old guy who falls over and breaks their hip, because you haven't got any muscle mass there to support you. So
there's a look into my future. Thank you for that.
So eating plenty of protein. So I always say to people, when we're thinking about what you're going to eat, plan for protein, scavenge for carbs, because protein needs to be planned, because most of it needs to be cooked, or you need to think about buying a cooked version. So chicken, fish, boiled eggs, like beef, turkey, whatever. And then I always say scavenge for carbs, because if you went into your kitchen, you could find some carbs right now, couldn't you? Microwave rice, like pasta, bread, put it in a sandwich, whatever. So I, for lunch, I would have, you know, if you like sandwiches, go for maybe some wholemeal or seeded bread, because that will give you, especially seeded bread, will give you some healthy fats, some omega-3, and then some lean meat. Like you could have a tuna sandwich or chicken or turkey, put some salad in it, because green stuff, right? We all know we're meant to eat green stuff. So
and
do
you don't
that.
Mean, and then you don't mean green M&Ms and jelly babies, do you?
Unfortunately not. Okay. Those can be part of a healthy, balanced diet, but we need some other stuff in there too.
Okay.
So if it's like, I would say to people, eat stuff that's convenient to you as well, because, you know, if I said to you, yeah, you've got to make this humongous freaking salad from scratch every lunchtime, you're going to be like, well, I'm just not going to do that. So what's the point? No. So I always say I'm the laziest nutritionist in the world, right? I use microwave rice. I use chicken that's been pre-marinated in like silver trays from like Sainsbury's or whatever. I even sometimes buy pre-chopped vegetables that I just put in the microwave, because like, why not? You know, being healthy is not about cooking from scratch every single day. It's about making the best choice for you. And if that means you've got to factor in convenience because you haven't got the time or the capacity or the inclination to cook, then why not? So yeah, if you like a sandwich or something, just go for a sandwich, but pack loads of stuff into it, loads of flavor. Like I love like turkey pesto and salad. That's really nice because the pesto is really tasty. Seeded bread for the omega-3s, loads and loads of turkey, you know. So yeah, definitely protein. Protein all the time.
One thing I do occasionally eat, but I don't make a point of having it in, and it is something I could do, unless you tell me that's a bad idea, is in the office. I do actually like tuna.
Oh, nice.
But I don't like mayonnaise. And also, if you get a tuna sandwich in Marks and Spencer's or something, it's always tuna mayo. It's almost like tuna mayo is now a thing. You cannot separate them anymore. So I quite like eating a tin of tuna on its own.
Yeah. Or, do you know, balsamic vinegar all over tuna is really nice. So you could get a little bottle of balsamic and keep it in your desk drawer. And then you can even get those tuna pouches, can't you, which are flavoured. I mean, personally, I think it's a bit like cat food because it comes in the same sort of pouch. And
the way you've just
like
described that does make me think it's cat food, yeah.
But yeah, you can get those like flavoured ones that, you know, like tuna with sun-dried tomatoes and stuff like that. But yeah, like tuna and balsamic's really nice.
But it is acceptable then just to eat a tin of tuna out of the tin.
Yeah, why not? If that's the difference between A, you eating and not eating, or B, you eating that and then just grabbing some sort of convenience like pasty or whatever, then the tuna is going to win every time.
Yeah, Cornish pasties from, or sausage roll from Greg's, that kind of thing. That's the sort of stuff you shouldn't be having.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't eliminate it from your diet if you like it, but I wouldn't make it a staple, put it that way.
You see, that's the problem. I'm a routine person. I would go months and months and months without having something like that. And then when I have one, it's like, oh, that was good. And I'll do it again the next day. And then it will become a thing for maybe a week or 2 weeks. That's really what you shouldn't do, isn't it?
That's really, really common. And more so in business owners, because we do get fixated on things. But also a lot of that can be about restriction. So if you are purposefully or even subconsciously restricting a certain food because you've categorized it as bad or naughty or unhealthy, then, you know, that restriction will lead to you eventually binging on that food, because our perception of a restriction dictates its impact. So if you perceive that, oh my god, I'm not allowed sausage rolls, I never eat them because they're really bad for me, at some point your brain's going to go, hey, remember sausage rolls? And like the floodgates are going to open, you'll be like, holy shit, I'm having six sausage rolls every day. So I think including like a little bit of those sorts of foods in your daily diet or weekly diet is the way to go. Like I always say to my clients, no food is off limits. You're allowed to eat whatever the hell you want, but you have to believe that for it to really work. Because once you say to your brain, there's no restriction, I could have a sausage roll every day if I wanted one, suddenly you don't want one.
I suppose, yeah. It's like, we're like children, aren't we? You tell a child they can't have something and they want it. You tell them it's there for them whenever they want and they're not that bothered.
Exactly. So, it's just like I would include foods that you deem to be naughty. Like, I hate all that terminology. That's another thing as well. You know, nothing is, the poison's in the dose, as they say.
Sins.
Oh, don't, please. I can't say enough about Slimming World. I absolutely just, people wonder why I'm so sort of vehemently against them. But I have to pick up the pieces of people who've been Slimming World members for 20 years. And that the lady who's been with me for nearly 4 years now, she's an ex-Slimming World member, and her relationship with food is awful. And that's why it's taking us so long to sort it out. And that's why I'm so passionate about telling everyone their shit.
I love that. So you mentioned earlier on about being in a calorie deficit, so that you're eating a certain amount of calories, but you're also burning a certain amount off. When you're typically a business owner, unless you're out running around meeting people, you can literally stay at a desk without moving all day other than to use the loo.
Yeah.
What's the best way to make sure that doesn't happen, that you do have some kind of movement within your life?
Yeah, I would say if you don't move at all, like, don't feel like you have to join some stupid boot camp or do like extreme exercise or anything. Walking is awesome because you can do it for longer at a higher intensity. And for that reason, it burns lots of calories. But the reason that I love walking and I get all of my clients to do it is the mental health benefits and the cognitive benefits as well. So, you know, it can really help with increased productivity. It can help with creativity. It can help with focus and concentration. It can be calming. It's really good for your mental health, depending on where you live. I can't quite see it, but I can nearly see the sea out of my window because I live in Poole. I'm very lucky to be able to walk along the seafront for my walk. So obviously that's super good for my mental health. But if think of it this way, like, yes, I know that we all want to work all the time because we love our businesses most of the time and we're really excited to do stuff. But think about it as a return on investment. So if I said to you, look, could you invest 20 minutes of your time in your health, right? And that's how I normally start it, because everyone's like, oh, of course I could, because everyone's too embarrassed to say, I will not even leave my desk for like 15 minutes. So I'm like, right, okay, let's use that 15 minutes. We're going to reinvest it in your health, and you're going to go for a walk. So go for a walk, and then they do that consistently for a week. And what they find is when they get back to their desk, because I either get them to do it in the morning or in the middle of the day, they feel fresher, they feel more focused, they actually get more shit done. And it's particularly if they do lunchtime walks. So then what happens, that 15 minutes that they've invested, by the time they've been doing that for 2 weeks, they've maybe got 20 minutes a day at the end of their day back, because they're quicker at doing stuff, they're calmer, they're more solutions focused, they're more creative. So then we've got, okay, well, we've got 20 minutes now. What are you going to do with that 20 minutes? Do you want to reinvest it back in your health? Let's make the walk longer, or let's have two walks. So knowing how to, I mean, that's something that I developed, because that is a way to get at business owners, right? If you reinvest this, you'll get this back and it will be better and you'll be more productive. So I would say, think of it that way. You're investing in your health and it is going to give you benefits in your business as well. Just 15-20 minutes a day for a walk, start off like that. And I would say, be really mindful, like, notice, do you feel any different when you come back from the walk? Are you getting more work done? Have you come up with a new amazing idea? Are you a bit nicer to your staff and less of a dick to be around? You know, it's all of those benefits for your business. It's not just, oh my God, I've got to go for a walk. It's so much more than that.
But again, I agree with everything you've said, but I still do that again in fits. So I'll say, right, I'm going to start walking now. I'm going to make it happen. And it's usually after I've come back from holiday where I've been self-conscious about myself compared to other people. You see by the pool, right, I'm going to do it. I'm going to go home and I'm going to go walking every day. And I'll probably do it every single day for maybe 6 or 7 or 8 days.
Yeah.
And then it'll tail off and then it'll stop. And then I'll think, bollocks to it.
Yeah. So a couple of things that you can do. So first of all, are you coming back from holiday and then deciding you're going to walk 5 miles a day?
No. It's usually, as you say, about half an hour.
Okay, good. So what I would do is track it because...
Apple Watch, I do.
Perfect. So tracking it and maybe putting that, I mean, I'm a massive geek, right? Because I used to be an IT consultant. So I track everything on a spreadsheet. So I take all the data off. Look, I've got two things to track my health. So I take all the data off and put it on a spreadsheet so that I can see where I'm improving and where I'm going wrong. But if you track things, it's kind of a two-pronged approach because, first of all, it allows you to see consistency and it allows you to become more motivated because of it, because you're filling in, you know, ticked off today, ticked off the next day. But that has been shown to give people a dopamine hit. So it actually affects, you know, if you're trying to wire in this new behavior, tracking the fact that you're doing it is more likely to do it because it's rewarding you for tracking. So it's saying, hey, do you know what? This behavior is good because you've tracked it and you've done it 3 days in a row. And then the same study, I think, found that you can get a further dopamine hit about the same thing by sharing your progress with other people. So for example, so if you decided, right, I'm definitely going to go for a walk every day, but I'm going to track it and maybe give myself some little targets like a 5% increase in my steps every week, for example, or I'm going to try and do the same walk, but I'm going to shave a few seconds off it every Monday or whatever. And then maybe sharing that with your partner at the end of the week going, oh, wow, look, I've done all of this and, you know, I've increased my steps, whatever. That motivation, because dopamine, people think it's our, you know, hormone of pleasure. It's actually to do with motivation, dopamine. So if you can sort of get little dopamine hits for doing stuff, it will motivate you to carry on doing it. Tracking and sharing.
It does. It makes you feel better. That problem I've got is if I go for a walk with my wife, she's got shorter legs than me. We walk the same time. We come back, I've done 3,000 steps, she's done 4,000. It's frustrating. It's genuinely frustrating.
Well, I am also a person of diminutive stature. This is a fun fact for you. I have been doing ultra walks. I set myself a massive challenge at the beginning of the year. And I was going to do one ultra walk, which was a 100-kilometer walk. Continuous overnight. Whoa. So I went on the website to sign up and they had 15 events over the year, and in an extreme WTF moment I just thought, oh, I'm just going to do all of them. So I have this Saturday just completed event 11 of 15.
Wow.
And I've got 100k walk on Saturday and then I've got another one the Saturday after. But on those walks, because I've got little legs, I can do about 120,000 steps in a day.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
120,000.
I think the most I've done in a day is about 144.
Bloody hell.
Yeah.
Most I've ever done is 22,000, and that's when we went to Universal Studios in Orlando.
Yeah, amazing.
And we did their Fright Fest in the evening where you're walking around and going through the haunted houses, and it's basically like a massive queue. So, you know, being British, loved that. And I was absolutely knackered. My legs felt like jelly by the end of it. But you've done 100,000 more than that in a single day.
Yes. And I've done... yeah, I did 6 100-kilometer walks in the space of 10 weeks, back to back, weekends.
All right. Well, no one likes a show off.
But you don't have to do that. You can start off with a 20-minute walk every day.
Yeah, 20-minute walk every day. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Or if you've got Vitality health insurance like I have and you get the benefits with the Apple Watch, you need to do a 30-minute walk at 70% heart rate to get your points. Well, and then you get your free coffees and your free cinema tickets and stuff. So Gamifies. That's what it's all about.
Exactly. Gamifying works, but mostly because of this dopamine hit. You know, like Duolingo where you get the streak. Streaks are very powerful, and you can just create your own on a little spreadsheet. You can just, like, each day you do it, just sort of like fill it in green, and then if you don't do it, you have to fill it in red. I mean, do you think I want to see a red square on my green thing of green squares? Absolutely not.
No. Right. Do you know what? We're out of time.
Oh wow. Okay.
We are out of time. I know. I'm shocked. I could just talk for you for hours. Before we wrap up. If somebody wants to get in touch with you, whether it's about, because we've not even mentioned your podcast, so please tell us about that as well. Whether it's your podcast, whether it's working with you as a nutritionist, what's the best way for someone to reach out to you?
So my website is food.ninja, which is very easy to remember. So you can contact me there. I am quite active on Facebook and Instagram. So on Facebook, I'm Hayley Food Ninja, and Instagram, I am the Food Ninja. And as I said before, aforementioned famous TikTok video. I'm kind of active on TikTok, but not as much. But any of those, website, Instagram, Facebook, I'm on them all.
And the podcast as well?
The podcast is called Rude Health, mostly because I am quite sweary. And, you know.
I've noticed.
Yes. And it is had a little bit change in direction. So I did a season last season and talked to lots of different business owners and stuff about their health. And now, because I work mostly with women, I am focusing a bit more on talking to women about how they feel when they get to 40 and over, because there's a lot of stuff that goes on, obviously. And one of the reasons I did my ultra challenge walks is because I had some quite serious mental health symptoms, which I, about 18 months ago, which I eventually found out were perimenopause symptoms. So until that happens to you, well, it's not going to happen to you, obviously, but until that happens to you, it's actually, you do actually think you're losing your mind. And the walks have really helped me with that. And I want to encourage more women to go on adventures, women over 40, because we're kind of sort of fade into the background and told that you're in decline, you can't do anything amazing anymore and all that kind of stuff. So Rude Health is really about more about women's health and showcasing women who are doing extraordinary things.
Okay, excellent. And if anybody is listening to this who is a woman in their 40s and was potentially wanted to be a guest on your podcast, they could reach out to you as well.
Absolutely. I would love to hear from any women who have maybe struggled with perimenopause, menopause, and didn't have any education or awareness, because that's another issue. And maybe they've sort of overcome some challenges and are doing something extraordinary. I would love to hear from them. Thank you.
Okay. So thank you very much for being on there. I've loved this, and I feel incentivized now. I feel enthused to go out and actually go for a walk, and I'm going to do it now.
Good. Do genuinely. It. And then plan your lunches for the week.
Well, it's Wednesday, so, you know, do it next week. But
turkey
yes.
and pesto sandwiches or tuna.
I just have the tuna. I genuinely actually like eating tuna from a tin. I don't know why. I hate cats. Yeah, you know, I act like one. But there we are. So thank you. Thank you for being on the podcast.
Thank you. Thank you so much.